Good morning, please be seated. I've just got a couple of notices. Oasis are collecting hygiene items, toothbrushes, toothpaste and soap for refugees. And if you'd like to contribute, if you could bring these items next Sunday and the Sunday afterwards, and then whatever's contributed, we'll deliver on the 26th to Oasis. You'll see at the back the shoebox appeal, which is for Oasis, which has been coordinated by Jan, and all those boxes are just now waiting to go. So you'll have heard that John and Claire Walters were in a road accident a few days ago. They are improving, but it was a bit of a shock to their system. It wrote their car off. Somebody drove into them while they were stationary waiting to go into a garage. But they are improving. And for those of you who know Jeannie Leggett, I spoke to her yesterday. She is not very mobile, but her husband John is organising various mobility aids for her so that she can at least get about on her own without having to be pushed in a wheelchair everywhere. So she is, this hit her very quickly. And she went downhill very rapidly. She has osteoarthritis, which was a rapid onset. She's hoping, though, that when she's got mobility aids, she'll be able to come back to church. So we look forward to that day. I don't think there's anything else, unless anybody knows something I've forgotten. Good.
Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Good morning and welcome to this service of Holy Communion on this 18th Sunday after Trinity. We are going to sing our first hymn, number 637.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. As we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us call to mind and confess our sins. Let's have some moments of private prayer, asking for the forgiveness of our sins. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than this. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Let us pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand for the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, increase in us your gift of faith that, forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to that which is before, we may run the way of your commandments and win the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading.
Our first reading comes from Isaiah chapter 25, verses 1 to 9. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name, for in perfect faithfulness you have done marvelous things, things planned long ago. You have made the city a heap of rubble, the fortified town a ruin, the foreigner's stronghold a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will honour you. Cities of ruthless nations will revere you. You have a refuge for the poor, a refuge for the needy in their distress, a shelter from the storm, and a shade from the heat. For the breath of the ruthless is like a storm driving against a wall, and like the heat of the desert, the silence, the uproar of foreigners, as heat is reduced by the shadow of a cloud, so the song of the ruthless is stilled. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich foods for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove the disgrace of his people from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord, we trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Psalm 23, if you will read what's in the bold prints. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 to 9. My brothers, you whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord, dear friends. I plead with Euodia and I plead with Syntyche to agree with each other in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, loyal yoke fellow, help these women who have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel, along with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our hymn now is hymn 138. Faithful Shepherd, feed me.
Faithful Shepherd, feed me.
Alleluia, alleluia. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. You have the words of eternal life.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus spoke in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted cattle have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, ill-treated them and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find.' So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed someone there who was not wearing wedding clothes. 'Friend,' he asked, 'how did you get in here without wedding clothes?' The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, 'Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen.'" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May my words today and all our thoughts reflect the word of God. Amen. Please be seated. Over the years, we've been invited to many parties of so many different types, from modest drinks parties to huge, full-blown affairs. So often we attended out of a sense of duty, and not because we particularly wanted to be there. The parable that we heard in our gospel story sounds like it was intended to be a full-blown affair, to celebrate a wedding, with all that that entailed in those days 2,000 years ago. Throwing a party can be a tricky and a stressful business. There are many questions that the host needs to ask, such as, how many people should be invited? What if no one turns up? How much food and drink should there be? Then there's the reluctant guest who says, "Sorry, I've got to stay in and wash my hair." Or says that they can't find a babysitter. And then there's the gatecrasher who just doesn't belong. Today's gospel spoke of God's kingdom as a party, and the giving of it sounds like it must have been about as stressful as ever. The people who were invited just wouldn't come. Some of them wouldn't take it seriously and went off to do their own thing. It's as if a person would say, "Sorry, I can't come to your party. I've got to go shopping." And others seem to have been so insulted to be invited that they beat up and even murdered those who came to fetch them. That was a very extreme response. I wonder what it was that made this party so unappealing. A welcoming feast for all is one of Jesus' favourite ways of speaking about the kingdom of God. But there are a few disturbing features to this particular description. Jesus really stressed God's anger at being rejected. The host is absolutely furious with those who wouldn't come. And as for the man who did go, but apparently couldn't be bothered to dress in the correct clothes, he was cast out into the dark, having been bound hand and foot. So what on earth are we today to make of the picture that this story evokes? Jesus is warning us about being too complacent. Yes, God does truly offer us a place in his kingdom, promising to fulfill every one of our needs, to wipe away our tears and to remove our guilt and our shame. As the prophet Isaiah said, but God deals with us as adults, not as wayward little children. God is not a magician or a fairy godmother who waves a magic wand over us to make everything work out well in the end. He's a God who invites us not simply to take our places at his banquet, but actively to prepare it with him. He invites us to begin the work of building up his kingdom in our lives and in the world in which we live. Saint Augustine suggested that the reason that the man in the story was ejected from the banquet was because the garment which he lacked was the one essential for the kingdom of heaven, love. The wedding garment is a symbol. To enter the kingdom of God, we need to repent and have a change of heart. But that's not the end of the story. This repentance must be continued in a life of love and compassion. Christians who fail to lead a life of service to others will find that merely acknowledging Christ is not enough. They run the risk of being cast out of God's kingdom, into the darkness, because they have failed to clothe themselves with the garment of love. We say that God is love, and we might be tempted to use that fact to excuse any real effort on our part to bring God's love to the people we meet. If so, we're like the man without the wedding garment. He had failed to prepare and just turned up, expecting to be admitted. But the kingdom of God isn't like that. We are given the opportunity to choose in our lives, and the choices that we make can have enormous consequences. People often make light of the Christian faith. The church sometimes tends to be seen as an ineffective body of people who hold social events and jumble sales. In fact, for all its faults, the church, as a means of communicating the Christian faith, is not something at all to be made light of. For it is the Christian, if the Christian faith is true, then it is, quite literally, a matter of life and death, which reflects the parable in today's gospel story. Other people oppose the church and the faith for which it stands with a real loathing and even hatred, like the people who murdered the servants in the parable. And others find themselves in it, but not really knowing why, thinking that they can be Christians without letting it really touch them, like the man without the wedding garment. The parable tells us that how we respond to God's invitation is vitally important. As members of the church and as people at a party, let's make sure that we do our part to make the invitation clear. Amen. We stand to say the Nicene Creed. On page 6.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated.
In our prayers of intercession, we've used the alternative responses at the bottom of page 9. Oh, sorry, the top of page 8. The response to Lord, hear us will be Lord, graciously hear us. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, we have been drawn here today by the power of God's love. Into that infinite love, let us now gather all those for whom we pray. We pray for the Holy Spirit to keep leading the people of God, and for all in the diocese who teach and show the Spirit's ways. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Father God, we pray for the world that you have gifted to us. Help us to love this world and to care for it. Help us to protect the environment. Help us to guide ourselves and others in maintaining this world, especially the animals and wildlife that are endangered. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously.
In our diocesan prayer guide today, we're asked to pray for St. Mark's Church in Famagusta and for their congregation, which is made up mainly of international students from Eastern Mediterranean University. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord God, we pray for all those in this world who are oppressed, brutalized, or otherwise treated badly. We pray in particular for the ordinary people of countries where many military regimes seem to be intent on ignoring their people's dire needs. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Dear Father, we pray for our diocese. We give thanks to the wise counsel of Michael, our bishop. And we give thanks for the clergy who work diligently across the diocese. We give thanks also for the often unsung people who work tirelessly and voluntarily to supplement the ministry of the clergy. May they all be enriched and enrich us with their ministry. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Father God, our prayer corner has many names on it requesting our prayers. Help us to focus on praying for all those who need our prayers. Lord, you are the God of compassion. Help us to try to mirror that compassion. In a quiet moment, let's just think and pray about all these people who need our prayers. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Heavenly Father, we commend to your loving arms all those who have died in faith. We remember in particular George V, who died last week. We ask you to welcome them all into your kingdom and to grant them everlasting peace. Let's take a quiet moment, especially to pray for those who we know personally who have died or for whom we commemorate an anniversary at this time. Father God, we thank you for the privilege of working with you to spread the good news of the gospel, the good news of your saving love. By your grace, may we become the people that you intend us to be. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Please stand for the peace. Blessed are the peacemakers. They shall be called children of God. We meet in the name of Christ and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace, special signs. Because we cannot shake hands. So, be with you all. Yes. We are going to sing now the offertory hymn, during which the collection will be taken. Hymn is six, sorry? 634.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the wine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. We shall follow the Eucharistic prayer too on page 11. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, Lord God, our light and our salvation. To you be glory and praise forever. From the beginning you have created all things, and all your works echo the silent music of your praise. In the fullness of time, you made us in your image, the crown of all creation. You give us breath and speech, that with angels and archangels and all the powers of heaven, we may find the voice to sing your praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. How wonderful the work of your hands, O Lord. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embraced a people as your own. When they turned away and rebelled, your love remained steadfast. From them you raised up Jesus, our Savior, born of Mary, to be the living bread in whom all our hungers are satisfied. He offered his life for sinners, and with a love stronger than death, he opened wide his arms on the cross. On the night before he died, he came to supper with his friends. And taking bread, he gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Jesus is the Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Savior of the world. Father, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. We remember his dying and rising in glory, and we rejoice that he intercedes for us at your right hand. Pour out your Holy Spirit as we bring before you these gifts of your creation. May they be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy things in your presence, form us in the likeness of Christ and build us into a living temple to your glory. Remember, Lord, your church in every land. Reveal her unity, guard her faith, and preserve her in peace. Bring us at the last, with all the saints, to the vision of that eternal splendor for which you have created us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, with whom, and in whom, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. Now let us pray with confidence as our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Let us pray. We praise and thank you, O Christ, for this sacred feast, for here we receive you. Here the memory of your passion is renewed. Here our minds are filled with grace, and here a pledge of future glory is given, when we shall feast at that table where you reign with all your saints forever. Amen. And now we say the prayer after the communion together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Please stand for the blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. We sing together the final hymn, 678, The Hand of God Has Guided.
Thank you. Even